Okay, let's look at the binocular we teased you with at the beginning of this video. This is the 20 degree 10x80, sometimes referred to by people as the Kriegsmarine 10x80, simply in virtue of the fact that it was in service with Germany's Second World War Navy. This binocular has 20 degree cranked eyepieces this time. So the one we were looking at previously, the flat glass, you'll remember was 45 degree, this one is 20 degree. Now clearly, if the binocular is tilted up too far, these eyepieces are going to find themselves pointing at the ground. In fact, the limit is around about maybe 40, 45 degrees. The binocular was predominantly used for looking at the horizontal up to about 30 degrees at extreme range. So approaching aircraft, attacking ships, ships that might be just over the horizon where you might be able to see their smoke and that kind of thing. Consequently, the binocular is particularly comfortable. It gives you a very good over the top of the binocular view, and obviously the eyepiece position is ideal for that kind of positioning. Now, the binocular was used for aircraft identification. It was pressed into service in that way, but mostly the binocular was used for general observation, target identification, also to direct the fire of shipboard artillery onto its target. In a lot of those situations, these binoculars were fitted to a calculating machine, sometimes with direct links to the guns actually on the ship, used to direct fire. It's not normal to encounter this binocular with any kind of original mounting. The mountings were often preposterously large. Certainly the calculating block, you wouldn't expect to find them on that, I don't think. It needs a substantial mount to actually carry it. Now, just a word about the mount that we've got it on here. This is actually not original, of course. This is a modern mounting. This is the kind of thing that you typically find on a Helios or other brands like the Helios Quantum. It's a good mounting. It's good enough for this job. It's got a fairly nice slipping clutch. It's got hard stop, so if the binocular bumps back, we won't do any damage to it. And the same at the front as well. There's a hard stop there that actually stops that. And it's got the right kind of, with these clutches, you can adjust the feel of the binocular to give you quite a smooth opportunity to pan around with it. Now, it's probably only fair to say about this binocular that of all of the German large aperture binoculars, this is the pick of the bunch. A good one of these, that with good optics all through, will deliver a truly stunning view. The equal of anything you're likely to find available today. Probably not in as light and convenient a format, but certainly the quality of the view that these oversized eyepieces and oversized prisms deliver really is still quite extraordinary. Let's just look at the binocular in a little bit more detail. As usual with this type of binocular, it's the basic optical furniture that makes the instrument so impressive. We've got large aperture 80mm object glasses at the front here for high resolution and large light gathering power. These, all the optics are from the shot glassworks. At the rear of the binocular, we've got massive oversized prisms and these extremely generous eyepieces. If you can bear down on these, you can see that the clear aperture of these eyepieces, the first lens here, is a whacking 36mm in diameter. So the binocular really is incredibly comfortable as you address it with your eyes. And of course, we've got that same 8mm exit pupil with this binocular, exactly the same as we had with the 1080 flat glass, of course. Other features on the binocular to aid user comfort are a brow rest. This is the smaller of the two. There is a full wraparound brow rest. I'm going to show you that in just a moment. The interocular adjustment is achieved with the knob on the side here. That's just a simple twist, and you can see on the edge here we've got numbers so that the user can remember his number when it's his turn to use the binocular and just dial that in so that he's ready to go straight away. The filter adjustment system that we've got on here. It's got a little wrinkle with it. We've actually got a day and night lever, so we've got it labeled night here and Tag day. This is for switching in either a contrast enhancement filter, a yellow contrast enhancement filter, for seeing through haze and that mush that you get in between the sea and the sky. The contrast enhancement would actually help with that. You've also got a neutral density filter on there as well, for when you're trying to make observations closer to the sun, in case there are aircraft approaching from the brightest region of the sky. Flip the lever over and we've got a filter specifically to combat the effects of searchlights and anything that would cause dazzling when the binocular was being used at night. We've got two caps here for the desiccator system. So if I undo one of these, quite common to find binoculars without these. It's possible to actually get replacements of these caps. These are actually manufactured of Bakelite, so I'm going to be a bit careful with that. This can be removed very easily. And you can see that we've got a mesh there, a copper mesh full of something like silica gel. These can be cooked in an oven, dried out and then reinserted to help keep misting and fog away from the interior of the binocular. It's also furnished with a very impressive air drying system where dry air can be passed through the binocular as a process of servicing. And these pickup points we can actually see on the binocular here. I can probably show them to you best if I actually turn it round. We've got the Luft aus at the top there, and at the rear we've got Luft ein, so we can pass the dry air in through the binocular and vent it out the front. Normally these binoculars had a positive air pressure of around 110% of the atmospheric pressure. Presumably that means it would be 110%, it would be 10% above the normal atmospheric pressure. I'm assuming that's what that means. The binocular is also fitted with a open frame finder. This one is a little bit neater than the one on the flat glass. We can see we've got this kind of gun sight arrangement, and the rear sight is a very simple notch there. So we obviously just line that up to quickly point the binocular at the target. The sight that you see here is actually a reproduction. So this binocular actually came to me without this, and this is a reproduction model. This kind of thing and the caps can sometimes be found on the internet, or you might be able to find them at Astroboot on their vintage optics section, which can be quite useful for this kind of stuff. The one other thing on here that's non-standard are these winged eye cups that I've got on here. I've put these on, they're actually Japanese made. I find these are very comfortable. They can be folded down very easily like this and make the binocular a lot more comfortable to use. Other features that you can see here are the port for the reticule illuminator. It's quite normal for this binocular to have as standard, it has a graticule fitted in one of the eyepieces. This is a series of crosshairs so that the pointing position of the binocular can be established quite precisely. It's normal to encounter this binocular with that removed. Bearing in mind they're 70 years old, it's probably had a number of owners. One of them sooner or later ends up undoing the eyepiece and removing that graticule. The other thing that might be worth bringing to your attention here is an addition by us, which is the dovetail mounting bar here. We've put a dovetail mounting bar on this so that we can put it not only on this tripod but on other mountings as well. And you'll often find when you encounter these, you'll find non-standard mountings have been added by previous users, sometimes just so that they can put it on a tripod, a simple metal plate that would give it a 3/8 Whitworth or a 1/4 Whitworth mounting point. And here is exactly the same model binocular, this time with all of its standard onboard accessories. Obviously that doesn't go for the tripod. The mounting we've got it on here is something that we've cobbled together. Because of the weight of this binocular, we've got counterbalance weights on this side of it. We've got it on a dovetail bar, like I pointed out before, and on this L bracket here that we're carrying it with. But it looks like a much bigger binocular, and that's because it is, once we've got these accessories fitted to it. Obviously we've got the hood that we were talking about, similar to the one on the 1080 flat glass, only the difference is this one has actually got some horizontal adjustment on it as well. So as you make a compensatory change for the interpupillary distance, remember turning this knob just here, this can actually cope with that and give you a slightly more centered view using the hood. As I flip that up, that's where the other little brow, the simpler brow support should be. It's actually missing off of this binocular. Other features that we didn't see on the other one are these rain guards, which can just be unclipped at the front here and lifted up for inspection of the optics at the front here. You notice a row of holes to allow seawater to escape, and also we've got these rain guards that actually just fit at the front here. I'm being very careful with these because they're actually made of Bakelite. Later on they actually put aluminium versions of this on there, and they clip back out of the way like that. So this is more characteristic of the look of the binocular when it's in a more original condition. Now there were three manufacturers of the 20 degree 10x80 Kriegsmarine. The one we were showing you previously was Carl Zeiss, the primary contractor. There was also Optical Precision Work of Warsaw, Poland. And finally, and most bizarrely, Ducati of Italy. And that's the same Ducati as who later on after the war were famous obviously for their motorcycles rather than their binoculars. This is the only significant binocular they manufactured. This is a Ducati manufactured binocular. Their code was MLR, and if we come in tight on the nameplate here, you should be able to see the MLR coding. The model we're looking at here is number 200202. Now we're actually lucky enough to have another example of this, and I'm going to show you that a bit later on because it's in bits. So we'll look at that shortly. Other features on this binocular that we didn't see on the other one were chain restraints on the airlines. Both of these are actually tied down, and if we look at the back of the binocular, you can see we've got chain restraints on there as well. You can see that the adjustment for the eyepiece focusing has actually got these numbers on here. So once again, the operative can make a note of his ideal settings. That can be written down on a chalkboard nearby, and whoever's using the binocular just sets it up for their settings. Okay, quick change of gloves because this one is a bit grubby. Now the Italians named their binocular project the Bimar. That's a shortened version of Binocolo Marino Bimar. Now I've actually got another Bimar here. Now the beauty of this one is I'm going to be able to show you some of its internal details. I love you to bits, but taking a binocular like this apart just to show you the inside, I'm afraid the love doesn't quite run to that. This is one that's actually been in my workshop for, let's just say, for over a year, and try to stay friends about it. I'm going to take the end off. Just one little interesting point. The number on this Bimar, you can see the MLR code here again. You'll notice that this one is number 205. So bearing in mind the other one was 202, these two must have been friends once before. They must have been on the same event assembly bench in 1943. maybe 1944, when these were made. Only 400 of these were ever actually supplied to Germany by Ducati. They carried on making a few just after the war. In fact, here's an advertising hoarding for one. This is from a page of a magazine. And you can see they carried on making these from about 1947. And it's believed they sold another 150. All with commercial logos on, all in a thick blue paint, most of them. This one has definitely had war experience. Sad to say, I think most of the damage that's been accumulated by this binocular was probably actually done since the war. But the good thing about it from our point of view is I'm going to be able to just lift this away and show you some of the internals of this binocular. Now we can see the mirror cage arrangement, and we can see the filter wheel down here as well. Unfortunately, I don't know whether you can see it, but this binocular has actually got some quite severe damage onto the first prism. Probably going to live with it, to be honest, after I've stabilized it. This is one of these little projects that I like to come back to now and again when I get a bit depressed and just do a little bit and then rebox it up again. I'm probably going to just do something to make sure it doesn't get any worse, because it's not making a big difference to the optical path. So I'm probably going to stabilize it and then black it out, because I'm not expecting to be able to get a replacement prism for it. But there you go, interesting to see the internal there. Now I'm just going to show you the optical elements, because we've got the objective out of this as well, and we've also got the eyepiece broken down, so I'm just going to show you both of those. But before we dispense with this, another little detail just to show you here, the desiccator cap this time, as well as the sea spray cap made of Bakelite, both have got the MLR code on the inside of it. I don't know whether you can come in tight and just see that. The MLR code is actually printed on the inside of this cap. I find that very slightly surprising. I was saying earlier to you that I think some of the incidental furniture on these binoculars were often shared between manufacturers, but here's a classic case of it not being shared. Ducati actually had another contractor make up these Bakelite components for them, so that they would have them locally. One of the things I want to just quickly show you here while I've got the chance is the illuminator for the graticule, which, as you can see on the one that needs the repair work doing on it here, has been completely ripped off. But what it does let us see is the red crystal window. It's tinted red to provide mediation of the light, and again for use obviously in nighttime, so that you don't so that the user didn't lose his dark adapted vision. But you don't normally get a chance to actually see that. This is the objective and ocular component set from the binocular we were just showing you there, and you can see that the objective, you can see there's a bit of damage on there. So far all I've done is stabilize that to make sure it doesn't get any worse. The rest of the lens is in pretty good order. You can see it's a cemented two-part doublet, an achromatic doublet, and it really is quite a beefy piece of glass. This weighs about 500 grams, so we're talking about around about half a kilo weight there, so it really feels quite substantial. The glass is about 28 millimeters thick, not too surprisingly with that weight. The eyepiece, the orthoscopic eyepiece, is five element, and we can see the grouping here. We've got a cemented segment of four elements together, and a single element that is the eye lens. So this would be the arrangement. There's a small barrel holding these apart inside the eyepiece. Normally speaking, you would encounter a clear blank over here. This would simply have a 4mm thick glass blank in front of it. So basically it gives you something to remove and dispose of if there's any kind of injury in use from cleaning or anything else, so that the binocular can be restored to good order with a very cheap component like a simple glass blank. Let's just round this section off by showing you a couple of quite nice historical images. This one clearly shows the 10x80 on a fire control calculator. Quite a good image. Here's a nice one showing a sailor and a 10x20 having a quiet moment. This is the 60 degree 12x60, and by now you'll have realized that the 60 degree is referring to the inclination of the eyepieces away from the horizontal. So there's the horizontal line, the eyepieces are cranked like this. The binocular is offering 12 times magnification and with 60 millimeter object glasses.